It is my pleasure to welcome Mr. Anurag Thakur.
Thank you.
He's also, for people who are who love sports, he's an avid sports person and created one of the most fascinating, most beautiful cricket stadiums in Dharamsala. If you ever go up to Dharamsala, you have to visit it. It's one of the most beautiful cricket stadiums in the world. He also serves as a vice president of the Indian Olympic Association, and we're delighted to have him here this afternoon. Anurag, so what we're going to do is maybe pick up the conversation from actually an op-ed piece you wrote in the Times of India about a month ago on new politics. And you talked a lot about the youth, but about empowerment, employment, and education. Can you tell us a little bit about that? Because we don't see a lot of people talking about that, particularly out of the younger parliamentarians.
Good afternoon, everyone. Arjeev, India is young and restless. And our youth has dreams and aspirations. And as a policy maker, I believe it's our duty to help them achieve their goals. And to achieve their goals, I think we need to focus on new politics. And the agenda of new politics is that the new politics should be focused on development-oriented, transparent and accountable politics. And I propose the three key elements of new politics should be education, employment, and empowerment. An educated society is the most important, or you can say the key element for any nation in today's world. If we look at the UNESCO figures in the recent report, India has the most illiterate, aged people all over the world. It's about 287 million people, which comes about 32%. And if you look at if we are looking at a stronger India, I think it's very, very important to have an educated society. And to achieve that goal, we need to work on 100% literacy rate. We have to make that an imperative. To achieve that goal, I think as a society, we need to work on that, not only by passing a Right to Education Act, but as a society, we need to work on that. Like I have about 100 kids who I take responsibility to take them to the schools or enroll them into the schools. As a youth wing, we tried to start a project called Aao School Chale Hum on Atalji's birthday, who started the Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan. We went to the slums and started a drive to educate and people and create awareness to start taking their kids to the school. I think it's very important, along with the education, you provide them the vocational training, skill development centers. I personally feel not only education, along with that, as I said, employment and empowerment. If you look at the employment sector in India, only 3% people are employed under the organized government sector, right. 4% under the private organized sector, and 93% under the unorganized sector. So there's a huge scope to work in that area. And if you look at the overall figures, I think we are adding 1 million workforce every month, and right. It's a big task in front of India. If you look at the corporate sector, the employees of corporate sector in India has an average of 28 years, whether in China it's 37 years, America 38, Japan has 44 years. So we have a large young population of workforce available with us, but unfortunately unable to create that kind of employment opportunities in India. It's very important when you talk about the 21st century. I believe youth has to play a very, very important role in the nation building process. Being the largest stakeholder, we must involve and engage them in building a new India, a stronger India. So that is why I said the three key elements should be education, employment, and empowerment.
In terms of, let's take each of these, because I think they are all equally important from an India perspective. When you talk about education, you come from Himachal Pradesh, which actually has a very good record on education. Are there some things that worked in Himachal from your perspective? What are some of the things you've done at the grassroots level that has been helpful to you?
I think if you look at the overall structure in India, look at four states. Kerala and Himachal, who has a large spending. Kerala spends about $627 per student. Himachal spends about $584 per student. If you look at West Bengal, they spend about $127 per student, and Bihar $100. there should be a parity as far as the allocation of budget is, you know, for education is concerned. So that is not there. Few state has a very good focus on education, few just go by the same kind of process which is going on for the last 6 decades. So I think to have a strong India, we need to have an educated India. That is, that should be the base for it. And we should must focus on making India a knowledge-based economy.
Right. Which is the theme of this
conference. In a federal structure, not only the central government, but the state government has to play a very, very important role. Right to education has been passed, but how many state governments accepted it or, you know, effectively implemented it? Right. That has to be seen. That is why I said transparent and accountable, you know, not only responsibility given to the politicians, but there should be accountability along with that.
Sure. And you're right, because the recent USAR report from Pratham talks about sort of the quality challenges we have in the country on education, the high number of dropout rates. In terms of empowerment, I know you had recently launched Honor Our Women. I think an important element, and we talked about this earlier in the morning, was gender empowerment in this country, which is very important, particularly when it comes to young girls going to schools. What are some of the things you're doing across the empowerment side, particularly for women?
You know, when I entered parliament, I thought that we make laws and with one law, we're going to change the country. But unfortunately, that doesn't happen. Any law is as good or bad as its implementation. And unfortunately, even despite passing that strong law for the safety and security of women, nothing has changed. 1,820 cases reported only in Delhi in the past 1 year. So I think as a society, we need to look at this, even from the government side. There has to be a strict action, and you know, people who do these crime should be taken to task. They should be put behind bars, and strict action should be taken against them. But at the same time, we are talking about cure, I'm talking about prevention. Yeah. It's better to create awareness among the society. So we started this organization called Honor Our Women, How Foundation. We have tied up with various school students. They come and volunteer for this job. On 8th, we are going to MIT school in Noida to do this program. Various schools have come forward. The students have come forward from schools and colleges. They do a Nukkad Natak, they do plays, they host programs. We call various sections of the society, like maybe from media, from films, from parliament. And we talk about this, how we can get rid of this crime against women. And you'll be glad to know that in the next 1 year, in the next 12 months, we're going to target more than 1,000 universities and colleges in this country and take this to more than 1 million students and engage them to create awareness in the society, to change the face of India, the image what we have created outside India. I'm sorry to say this, but you know, when you go out, people ask whether it is safe to travel to India. We should not have this image. And it impacts on the overall growth of the country.
Right, and I think you were mentioning you were traveling abroad and you heard from a lot of people that they're changing their travel plans because of this. And I just heard from Shailja earlier that some of our students have changed their research subjects to another country rather than India because of this. So we're in a political year, right? So everybody is looking very carefully at April, May to see what happens in the coming months. If the BJP comes into power, what should people expect from the education side, from the knowledge economy side? What do you think would be some of your priorities as a government if you win the elections?
If you look at the Vajpayee's government during the NDA regime, we started the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan focused on the primary education and overall education sector. But we also invested in the areas of infrastructure and created more job opportunities in this country. If you look at the first 5 years of UPA, they created 2.7 million jobs. Whereas in Vajpayee's tenure, we created more than 62 million jobs. So the focus was on creating infrastructure in every sector, whether it is sports, airport, education, industry, which has given an overall growth to this country from 4% to 8.5%. If we given an opportunity to come back and to serve the country.
Yeah.
To serve the country.
It's not our end, right?
Is it fine?
Okay, yeah.
Yeah. I think Mr. Modi has very clearly said that every state should have IIT, IIMs, and best of the best educational institutes. And I think he's also looking towards, as a party and as he's our prime minister candidate, he has set a clear goal that we need to have an educated society and to make India a knowledge-based economy. And I think for that, education has to play a very, very important role. He talks about creating more and more job opportunities. And how do you do that? Not only to based on the agrarian sector, but also to make India a manufacturing hub. And during our earlier regime, we have created many more jobs. But I personally feel today, if you have to do that, if you have to bring in more investments, you need to change the perception about India.
Right.
Anyone coming into India to invest should feel safe and secure. Law and order situation should be good. Once they are investing into India, the decision making should be fast. It should not linger on for 10 years. It should be fast. Others should be transparency in the system. You know, corruption is one blot on India which has, you know, not only the foreign investors, but also the Indian investors forced to think about whether they should invest in India or outside. I'm sorry to say this, I didn't want you to say this, but we need to change this image. Invest into the education sector as much as possible. We are not spending even 1/4 of what China spends on the education. Right. Look at the institutes. China may have more than 1,000 universities. We have 523 universities. So I think we need to gear up. We need to, you know, look into the education sector, make it an education hub rather than thousands of students going abroad.
Right.
We should make India a hub for education. If in the past India used to be a hub as far as the Takshila and Nalanda used to be here, why not now? We can still focus on that. We can still look into those areas, I believe.
In terms of, before we open it up to some questions, if you look at all of the grassroots travel that you do, what is it that the youth of India need? What are they asking for? Because you travel across the country. What message do all of us here need to hear about what's happening at the grassroots?
Ah, that's a tough one. India is a huge country, as you know, in a federal structure. When we look at various parts of India, I think I come from Himachal, where education level is good, but employment opportunities are not there. So the youth look for a better employment opportunities. But if you go to Chhattisgarh, few areas of Chhattisgarh will have a good employment opportunities, but Naxalite area will have a different set of problems.
Right.
From northeast to western India, I think overall, if you look at, there will be a different set of problems, aspirations, dreams. But if I have to sum up, I think overall, the three key elements will be what we included in the new politics: education, employment, and empowerment. Best of the quality education, not only quality education, but affordable
as well.
Education. At the same time, employment opportunities. How do you do that? Impart good skill development centers there and provide, it should be a industry linked. I think you should incentivize the industry to create more jobs, train people, and later on hire them. And incentivize that. Whatever they're going to spend on a child, that should be reimbursed by the government. Empower, why I say empower? I mean, because from Maharashtra to Manipur, from Kashmir to Kerala, it is very important to engage the youth in the nation building process. To make a strong foundation for a strong India, we must engage our youth, but we must educate our youth to make a strong and a better India, I must say.